My name is Jaime Stief. I work with the Tamarack Institute. You're here for the webinar called Centering Creative and Community Voices, Lessons from a Civic Revitalization Initiative with David Carey, Sam Carter-Shamai, and Duncan Field. As we get started today, we always like to start with a land acknowledgement. I'm joining from the traditional territory of the Neutral Anishinaabe and Haudenosaunee peoples, colonially known as Waterloo, Ontario. Naming what lands I'm calling in from is an act of truth, but we know that reconciliation takes much more than that. We encourage you all to share what traditional territories you are joining us from. And as we progress through today's conversation, it's always important to think about how we're also centering the voices of the Indigenous stewards of the land since time immemorial. And with that, I will hand the microphone to my esteemed colleague, Duncan Field.
Yeah, thanks so much, Jaime. Welcome everyone to today's webinar, Centering Creative and Community Voices, Lessons from a Civic Revitalization Initiative with David Carey and Sam Carter-Shamai. My name is Duncan Field. I'm an associate director here at the Tamarack Institute's Learning Center, and it's my pleasure to introduce today's discussion. I'm going to take a moment and just introduce our speakers. David Carey is co-executive director, and Sam Carter-Shamai is planning manager, planning and design of the Bentway, an organization that works to reimagine the public space opportunities beneath Toronto's Gardiner Expressway. Both David and Sam bring a wealth of knowledge and experience in planning, community building and engagement, arts-based community work, and much, much more. Very excited for today's conversation and just wanted to welcome you both, David and Sam. Thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you. We're super excited to be here, Darren.
So I'm going to pass it off to you to share a little bit about the Bentway, your mission, and the context of your work.
Thank you. Thanks for joining us, everybody. I've been with the Bentway pretty much since the beginning, so for about 6 years. And my background is as a fundraiser, storyteller. I like to think of myself as a city animator, and bringing cities to life has been the through line through my career.
My name's Sam, as Sue Hall said. I've been with the Bentway for a little bit less than Dave, but am always glad to be able to share the lessons that we have been developing and learning throughout this whole process. Excited to get into it and share with some lessons with you all and certainly get into some conversation too, I hope. Shall we jump right into the presentation then?
Yeah.
All right.
So today, Sam and I are going to walk you through a little bit about the Bentway's work, especially how we approach engaging community and creative voices through our practice. Before I kick things off, I should note to all of you that I'm actually taking this meeting from Pearson Airport. So if you hear any strange noises or weird passenger announcements, that's what that is. Sam, can you go full screen on that?
Yes, I'm just trying to get it set up here. We're on the first slide.
Great, So the Bentway is we are a not-for-profit and charitable organization that was founded in 2016. And our story really starts with the history of Toronto and the Gardiner Expressway. Those of you who live in Toronto or visited probably know it quite well. It's a large-scale kind of mega highway that runs elevated through the downtown core from Dufferin Street to the Don Valley Parkway. It's elevated for about 6.5 kilometers. And the Gardiner was built at this really interesting time in the late 50s, where these mega structures popped up all over North America, very much emblematic of mid-century ideals where car was king. People were interested in leaving urban centers to move to more suburban areas where they had more space, a front yard, a backyard. And the Gardiner Expressway was named after the first chairman of Metro Toronto, Frederick G. Gardiner, who has this wonderful quote that Sam and I just love. "I've looked at this darn thing from one end to the other, and I can't think of anything I would like to change." Now, our work is really founded on actually changing it and infusing contemporary urban ideals into this whole piece of infrastructure. So Toronto's changed a lot since the late 1950s. There's been a huge densification. There's a renewed focus on pedestrian safety and active transportation. And the Gardiner Expressway and other shared infrastructure like it, we believe, not only can be more but has to be more to serve the growing needs of our city. There's something like 250,000 people that live within a 5-minute walk up the elevated stretch of the Gardiner. And as you'll see in the top right, the Gardiner Expressway sort of cuts a straight line between Toronto's downtown core and the waterfront. And this made a lot of sense in the 1950s when Toronto had a real industrial waterfront full of malting silos and factories and railways. No one ever thought that anyone would want to live, work, or visit along Queens Quay there near Lake Ontario. And over the past 20 years, that's really, really changed. Toronto's waterfront is rich with offerings for recreation and arts and culture, and a huge population lives across this length, mostly in these dense glass towers, you know, small-scale units, people without a front yard or backyard. And so our project is based on repositioning the Gardiner as a piece of hybrid infrastructure that can serve both the needs of transportation above and public space and community connections below. So phase one of our site opened in 2018. It runs about 800 meters, just a few blocks from Billy Bishop Airport, next to Exhibition Place where the CNE is happening. And it's become a beloved backyard park, a platform for arts and culture, a real community connector, and we think a proof of possibility for how the Gardiner can perform in new ways. So since then, we've grown into a 25-person team. We have an operating budget of about $5 or $6 million. And although obviously we build public spaces and we operate spaces, we almost think of ourselves as programmers first, and the movement of the Bentway leading with creativity. So we're not an agency of the municipal government. We're not technically a city park, but we're something new. And this model is much more common in the United States. The Friends of the High Line in New York quite famously reimagined an abandoned elevated railway in New York, and we're in some ways building on the work that they've done. We think of our work along a series of intersecting streams, a huge focus on public art and performance, and working with artists and other creatives to reimagine the possibilities of the city, and using artwork as an opportunity to kind of break open our eye and tackle civic conversations in a new way. Obviously, we offer growing public space, a huge focus on shared celebrations, shared learnings and workshops, year-round recreation. And then an emerging area for us is our work in planning, design, and research practice that Sam is helping lead up. And we'll talk a little bit about that in a few minutes. We don't necessarily think of these streams as standing independently, but actually the full Bentwayness comes when they have tendrils that stream into one another. So pictured here in this orange box is the Bentway Phase 1 site and some highlights from the past 5 years below. Again, there are about 250,000 people that live on this map, and that number is expected to double in the next 10 to 15 years. Toronto's really going through an intense densification. And so what we're working on now is building on the work that we've done with Phase 1 and using those learnings to imagine how the rest of the corridor under and adjacent to the Gardiner Expressway can continue to evolve. So you'll see here sort of this imagined line of the Gardiner in its elevated form. And there's so many interesting opportunities and adjacent projects. In red, you'll note current and future transportation hubs. You might have read about the new Ontario line, which is a subway line being built in Toronto, our first subway line in a number of years. And at the west edge of the elevated stretch of the Gardiner, you'll actually leave that subway station and arrive to the Gardiner Expressway. Billy Bishop Airport is fronted by the Gardiner. Union Station is just a few steps away. And there are a series of exciting cultural attractions and other public spaces, a real hub of activity along the Gardiner. So rather than seeing this as an obstacle at ground level, rather than crossing under the Gardiner, this feeling of inhospitability and running the gauntlet, what if we imagine this as a series of gateways and attractive public spaces? So this becomes even more important right now as the City of Toronto is reinvesting in the Gardiner's future. The Gardiner is about 70 years old, And there's a huge endeavor to improve it in a state of good repair project. So hundreds of million dollars to ensure that the Gardiner can continue to serve its transportation function for another generation. So we have what's really a once in a generation opportunity to rebuild this infrastructure in a different way.
I'll pick it up here and tell you a little bit more about this nascent arm of policy work and research that my team is really sort of championing within the Bentway squad. As Dave mentioned, really, you know, we haven't been around for all that many years, but our impact is pretty profound. And the task before us now, in a nutshell, is how do we extend the sort of learnings that we have developed over these several years operating, programming, maintaining the space underneath the highway to extend beyond our initial phase one site and start to apply those lessons really across the length of the downtown core, at least underneath the highway. Again, the objectives and principles I think Dave has spoken to, but in a nutshell, it is how can we make it better? How can we transform this barrier, physical and psychological barrier, into a meeting place, a threshold, as opposed to a dividing line? As with many big and complex tasks, we don't try to approach this in isolation. And we're supported by a great number of partners. I think crucially, while the Bentway organization is not technically part of city staff, we are diving into this exercise hand in hand with our partners at the city. And it's really, as you know, I'll sort of reiterate this over and over again, it's about trying to sort of not necessarily change the heart of the physical structure, but change how we relate to it. How do we understand and use these spaces, use the latent capacity of this infrastructure towards other greater ends? It's not sort of instead of the original purpose, it's more of a yes and proposition at really the scale of a highway infrastructure across the whole city. So just to sort of give you a little bit of context in terms of where we're at in this project, we're pretty much close to the end of it. We're wrapping it up right now, but it has been the better part of 2 years that we have been focused on this work pretty intensely. I mean, really, this is the project that brought me into the fold with the Bentway, and you know, I'm thrilled to be able to continue this work. As I said, we are just approaching our final draft of the plan that we're hoping to bring to City Council and our municipal committees in the fall. And so it's a great time to sort of pause and reflect on how we got here. Again, just to reiterate the site area, as Dave mentioned off the top, we're really talking about the full extent of the city's central waterfront from Dufferin on the west end of the city, sort of over here, straight through to the Don Valley Parkway, the Don River on the east side. Our primary study area is sort of this western half, and the secondary study area is still very relevant to our considerations, but without getting all the way into the weeds of it, there are a number of major projects in the works over here. And so rather than sort of stepping on each other's toes, we're trying to work with and learn from these concurrent processes as they run alongside each other. In a nutshell, we're trying to identify and solve for the infrastructure challenges that are before us, to recommend opportunities to intervene on short, i.e. immediate, medium, and long-term timeframes. Part of this is also about establishing a cohesive sense of place, a sort of wayfinding and common identity that can stretch along this under-Gardiner space. And you know, for many years, it has sort of been understood as a non-space. I recall earlier in the process, I'd ask my friends, what do you think about the spaces underneath the highway? And they'd give me blank stares. They don't think about the space underneath the highway. And that's part of what we're trying to change, to give it an identity and place it in people's minds. Support the advancement of both demonstration pilot projects as well as a sort of larger scale interventions. And to that end, define the opportunities and scope for ways that we can start to sort of intervene and affect this change. A huge part, a really important part of this whole process has been our approach to consultation and engagement with the public. Again, as I said off the top, we don't enter into this exercise in isolation or thinking that we have all the answers ourselves. A big part of, I think, the strength of our approach is a willingness to, you know, concede that we don't have all the answers, and that what we do have most certainly is a willingness and a disposition to bring others into the conversation. So this is just a quick diagram to sort of set out the trajectory. And what I really want to drive home here is that it isn't exactly a linear process. It's not just step one, step two, step three, but in each phase, there are sort of built-in feedback loops so that we can stop, revisit, and check again before moving along. It's a constant sort of iterative process where we are you know, always trying to ensure that we're, you know, verifying and checking our own assumptions and conclusions as we go. Again, I'm going to keep on coming back to this. None of these tasks are done independently or by any single actor. This diagram is sort of one attempt to sort of visualize the number of interest groups and networks that we're working with and within. But this, even this, does not capture the totality of our project team or collaborators. I should mention, as I did at the beginning, that we are working hand in hand with the city as partners in this exercise. That includes easily half a dozen or more city departments, including the Waterfront Secretariat, Parks, Forestry and Recreation, the Transportation Services, Engineering, Construction Services, Economic Development, Transit, TTC, and others. There are other government organizations, Waterfront Toronto, Metrolinx, which is like our regional transit organization. There's all manner of resident associations, BIAs, and then of course there's our consultant team. We are supported by a great team of talented designers and landscape architects and urban planners. We've got support from Public Work, who really were instrumental in creating the phase one site that Dave sort of gave a little introduction to. We have support from the climate change and resilience perspective from Transolar Kilma Engineering. We have Indigenous design support from Two Row Architects, a local firm here in Southern Ontario. We have consultation support from Third Party Public. We have experience design support from Frontier, among others. And I know this is probably not the most exciting part, so I'm going to keep it moving. In order to effectively work with and engage this broad diversity of groups, we have to take different approaches. This is not a one-size-fits-all sort of solution. And so this diagram is an attempt to sort of set up an overview of how many different streams of consultation approaches that we were taking. On the left-hand side of the diagram, there are sort of our asynchronous approaches, things that people can engage with on their own time, in their own homes, in, you know, a manner on a timeline that suits them. They're largely hosted on our website. In addition to that, there were sort of synchronous or in-person events that, again, we tried to tailor to suit the needs and purposes of the myriad different groups that we were working with. This is everything from demonstration and pilot projects, which try to sort of take the ideas that might simply live in a policy document and, you know, make them tangible, make it something that you can touch, feel, and experience. We had specific outreach efforts towards, in this case, particularly trying to engage with Indigenous communities, given the historic connection, as Dave was mentioning, between the city and the waterfront, between those who have been here for eons stewarding and you know, living in these lands, as well as more recently unhoused communities who for decades have been making life and community underneath the bridge in the margins of our urban spaces. It would be, I think, irresponsible of us to engage in this work without trying to learn from those who have seen this place not only as a place but as home, as places that they again live and build community. Direct engagement with, you know, your more conventional stakeholders, as I said, the business owners, the property owners, residents, BIAs, and just everyday people who use the space. It has been a really great pleasure to sort of punctuate our policy exercise and our research efforts by just taking time with street team to walk the corridor and talk to people, and, you know, again, probe that question: what would make this better? What do you think about these types of spaces? Anyways, to give you a little bit deeper dive on some of these tactics, here's a sort of screenshot from one of the asynchronous activities that we did. We hosted an online interactive map where users could, you know, drop a pin that spoke to, you know, what they like, they don't like, destinations that bring them to the area, any ideas or suggestions. And as you can see, there was lots of engagement. One thing that I really liked about this platform, we did this with the Social Pinpoint was the name of the platform, if anybody's interested, is that it doesn't just provide the opportunity for people to offer their own comments, but it allows people to view other folks' comments and sort of upvote those that they think have merit. So I think this was a really robust way of starting off our process. Of course, we supplemented this with questionnaires, both online and in person, as well as any, you know, whole host of other tactics, which I have just described. To give you a really quick sense of the kind of engagement that we got from this map, here's just sort of an overview, you know, your classic word cloud, as well as some of the stats as terms in terms of how many sort of engagements and then, you know, how much traction we got through this method. And again, this was only one of many tools in our toolbox. Didn't just live online. We also hosted a whole number of different types of activities, from a street summit, which was sort of one part forum, academic talking heads, panel discussion sort of thing, one part interactive workshop session, and one part just good old street party with breakdancing music and, you know, other good things. We had an in-house sort of in-house open house activity as well, but, you know, we wanted to go a little bit beyond the classic sort of poster boards on easels, and so put together this interactive exhibition, really, of sorts that you can sort of see in the center and on the top left and bottom right. I think the strength of this approach is that by offering many tools and many different medium for people to engage with, we were not sort of narrowing our focus to any singular type of expression or mode of communication that people were comfortable with. We really tried to provide a wide breadth of ways to engage, ways to offer feedback. And I think the value in that is that more people are comfortable engaging, you know, in the way that they feel comfortable. The net result, and I'm pleased to say, that we got really, really good feedback. I think by sort of opening up the realm of possibility as to what or how people can engage, we were really encouraging people to offer their genuine feedback and, you know, express themselves fully. To sort of wrap it all up, here's a distillation, you know, just by the numbers of everything that we did. I didn't even touch on our technical advisory meetings, slightly mentioned our district specific stakeholder consultations. We had a website, there's the interactive map, the open house sessions, etc. I think it was a really robust process, and I am so pleased with the type of feedback that we got. But my favorite part of all of this is, as I alluded to earlier, when you can give people something that they can feel, something that they can experience as a means of consultation. And on that note, I'd like to pass it back to Dave to walk us through some of these really my favorite part, the exciting experiments and demonstration projects.
Thanks, Sam. You know, the Bentway we really believe in, you know, deep community consultation and ongoing community listening. We also believe really strongly in the power of creative experimentation as a driver of surprise and discovery. You know, we're not the type of organization that does white papers that just exist in theory, but we're really hitting the ground and testing ideas in practice. So a couple...
This is a final morning call for...
I might just jump in to say... Oh, are you good, Dave?
Sorry, there's an airport announcement. It's done. So I'm going to walk you through some pilot projects and demonstrators that we've put forward along the same track as the planning and consultation work that Sam has mentioned. And the first example tackles these unsafe intersection conditions that line the Gardiner. If you've ever been to a Jays game or a concert at the Scotiabank Arena in Toronto, you have this memory of traveling under the Gardiner and feeling unsafe as you pass by 8 lanes of traffic. So here were the raw conditions of these spaces. And then we ran a design competition in 2021 to engage creative voices to test out new ideas and new approaches on how these intersections could function. And this came to fruition with our Waterfront Reconnect project at 2 intersections at York Street and Simcoe Street. These are experiments that are live right now. They opened up in Q2 of this year. And some really, really interesting experimentations here. So the project in blue is testing a reflective vinyl coating that at the nighttime will reflect back the light from passing cars and reflect it back to illuminate the intersection, making it safer at nighttime. Because of course at night, these intersections get quite dark. This team has also played with this sort of sense of theatricality and humor and playing off the boom lifts that seemingly are always along the Gardiner, maintaining it and repairing it. And they've turned them into these warm and friendly and playful characters that people can pass by. And then the other project here in purple really looks at creating these micro moments of storytelling and sharing during that time when you're waiting to cross the intersection. We community sourced memories and stories and hopes of the waterfront and the Gardiner Expressway in the area to create these pixel walls. And it's been really wonderful to see adults and kids alike to kind of play with the pixels and create these micro moments of intervention. And Sam, maybe you can mention our creative partners on these two projects.
Yeah, absolutely. As Dave mentioned, this was the product of a national design competition, and the two sort of firms that led each of these respective design teams that you know eventually were selected were on the left side of the image, the York Street intervention. This was a firm out of Winnipeg who I'm embarrassed to say I always get their name a little bit confused because it's a long string of digits. It's their phone number. But as I'm sure many can sympathize with, it's been a long time since I could remember anybody's phone number. I'll look up the actual name and put it in the chat shortly. The other intervention was led by a team based out of Calgary called O2 Design. Both firms are architecture and design firms. And I am embarrassed, I can't remember the string of numbers.
One of my favorite spaces under the Gardiner is located just a few blocks west of our phase one site. The Gardiner isn't sort of singular in its conditions underneath in the 6.5-kilometer stretch. There's a number of different typologies. Some spaces like Bentway phase one, which have these wide open kind of grand boulevard. And these spaces, the city of Toronto uses basically as giant storage chambers. So they store equipment and vehicles and pylons, banquet tables for the city-run convention center next door. This is a space that's located exactly in between where the future subway station will terminate with the station there and the Bentway Phase 1 site. So we're really interested in working with the city and the convention center as creative partners to test out new forms of connectivity. What role could these spaces function in the future, and how could we draw people in and kind of start that dotted line between our two spaces? And so in 2021 and 2022, we did these wonderful demonstration projects, working with a creative partner again to use a public art intervention as an invitation to welcome Torontonians to discover these spaces for the first time. In 2021, you'll see that wonderful canopy of hanging lights. An artist named Raphael Lozano-Hemmer, a Mexican-Canadian artist based in Montreal. And in 2022, working with a Maine-based collective called Striped Canary on this beautiful picnic table installation. Both these projects drew in tens of thousands of people through a temporary path between our sites, not only to discover them for the first time, but to see them in a new way. You know, even walking into the raw spaces was quite engaging and interesting. But what we find is that when we work with a creative partner, they're able to show us possibilities of a space that we would never imagine directly. So I think what's illustrative about this approach is going along multiple tracks alongside community consultation, but being open to working with a creative partner to generate surprise and discovery and unearth something that not only did the community not realize was there, but that even surprised us. And then a third and final project that I'll walk you through takes on spaces like these, this is roughly about 20,000 square feet, very inhospitable, covered with these sort of fist-size river rocks. There's some debate, I think, either these river rocks are there to help with flood mitigation, or they've been placed there as a form of defensive architecture to keep people from entering this space, from sleeping in this space. But how might we use this as a laboratory to test out new ideas? So opening in about 3 weeks' time is a project called Staging Grounds that we've engaged agency out of New York, along with a local partner, Sheep, and a horticultural expert based here in Toronto, Isaac Crosby, also known as Brother Nature, that will be repurposing the downspouts that come off of the Gardiner Expressway, clearing rainwater and melted snow, using natural filters to clean and cleanse that water, and then again repurposing it on these beautiful experimental gardens growing flowering native plant species. This is a really exciting project that's testing these strategies for filtration and flood mitigation that one day could be applied across the Gardiner's length. And Sam and I are really, really excited that this project will open up on September 18th. So if you are based in the Toronto area, we welcome you to come check them out. So maybe as a my sort of closing words would be to encourage you all to think of your work along multiple tracks. Community consultation and ongoing community listening, I think, always needs to be central to our work. But the power of an artist's voice to unlock our eyes and the power of creativity and surprise and discovery, I think will really be transformative, certainly for our work here in Toronto. Sam, I wonder if you have any closing words of wisdom to share.
I think you've put it very well. The thing that I always come back to is, again, the best spaces are those that offer many reasons for many people to come to the same place. And it's kind of that same idea that we've applied to this consultation. How can we provide as many opportunities for as many different people to engage with these questions in as many different ways as possible? That depth of consultation, communication, I think really is valuable. I wouldn't have done this any other way. Obviously, there are things that I think we could have improved on for next time, but it is a constant state of learning. So with that, I think would love to know if there are any questions. And then we can open it up for some discussion, hopefully. I'm trying to keep an eye on the chat, but Jaime, is there anything floating to the top? I guess stop sharing for a second here.
Thanks so much, Sam and David. That's a really interesting presentation, and it's definitely spurred some thoughts and conversation. First question wanted to share was from an anonymous user. How do you balance sometimes competing interests between diverse interest groups, in brackets, such as local community priorities and cities or council?
I think the one answer is that it's not, again, it's not never this a common situation. No two situations are ever the same. And so we have to sort of take each one independently. But I will say that I think the best way to approach them is to just try and be upfront and direct with everybody who's involved. A big part of our of our approach, which I guess I didn't really mention here, is in trying to be as clear as possible from the outset what is on the table, what is flexible, what is malleable, what can we actually impact and affect. And this is not to say that we don't want to hear about these other things, but if we're clear and direct about what is within scope, what is within our ability to influence, and what are things that we would like to advocate for outside of, say, this process or along with other initiatives, I think that that really sort of helps to ensure that there is a productive conversation, even when, or perhaps especially when, there are differences of opinion or divergent approaches being presented, expressed.
Just to echo what Sam was saying, I think part of what makes our work so complex and so interesting are the various stakes in the Gardiner Expressway, from the city's transportation and engineering team, who's responsible for ensuring that it is safe and it runs as transportation, to our community planning team at City Hall that is looking to redevelop the entire waterfront strip, to the Parks, Forestry, and Recreation team, who are looking to build new public spaces adjacent to the expressway, to the local city councilor, to the Toronto water team that takes care of the stormwater, to the local business associations, to the local residents associations. It feels like sort of everyone in kind of the city, the civic constellation, has a view and a perspective on what the Gardiner Expressway needs to be. What we realized pretty early on was that there was no table or forum for all of those interests to come together. It was an extremely siloed conversation. So one of the first things that we did on this project was to build that table and to ensure that everyone had a voice and everyone was listened to, but to continue that the culture, a culture of yes and a culture of yes and, a culture of opportunity, rather than a culture of brick walls, no's. And no one's perspective was ignored or undervalued, but we tried to ensure that the conversation was really focused on summative work, that all of our perspectives together actually raised the conversation.
Yeah, that's interesting. And it spurred a couple other thoughts that have floated up, one of which is from Liz. What have you found most effective in persuading municipal governments of the value of community listening? And add a note, extra appreciation if you can address situations where the city already favors but has not yet fully committed to a certain direction for public space.
Great question. That indeed is like maybe the secret mm-hmm. sauce. For us, I think the power of taking ideas out of, you know, a white paper, out of a policy document, and really on the ground, and bringing municipal staff and elected officials to see the magic in action through a demonstration project, through a pilot project, or through an experiment. Because I think once they can see it and taste it, it becomes essential and undeniable. Actually, Sam, I wonder whether you could share your screen again and jump to the case study that we included at the end on our play season.
Yeah, for sure. I'm just trying to add something in the chat right now, but let's see if I can multitask.
Thank you. I would say that we find the greatest success with our municipal colleagues when we're out of a meeting room and we are on site with real people, seeing real things come to fruition, because it takes, it makes something much more visceral, right? And that's one of the reasons why we focus on programming in the real world. I'll just quickly go through a powerful example here that the Bentley undertook in 2021, sort of the midpoint of the COVID pandemic. We'd planned a season in 2020 that was all about play in the city, and we had to put that season on pause due to public health restrictions. But what we found was that the city was starting to think about how to keep people playing when we were all working from home and schooling from home. We had playgrounds that were, you know, that were quartered off. If you go to the next slide, Sam. So we actually engaged those city partners as agents of change with us, as part of series of pilot projects and on-site programming, and engage them as part of the work. Everyone from the parks team, the culture team, the engineers that take care of the highway, as well as our local business associations, local condo boards, and again, brought in creative partners. If you go to the next slide, Sam, our creative partners on this project will be listed here. And again, we wanted to keep this out of policy discussion, out of a meeting room, and really looking and learning from programming on the ground with real people to build that essentiality and that viscerality. So next slide. Together with all these partners, we created a season of play that actually extended from the Bentway site and beyond into the local neighborhood. We basically turned our neighborhood into a live playground where we were testing ideas together. And on a number of occasions, we rented a golf cart and we piled it in with city staff. And we actually drove around to each of these sites with live people engaging in the play. And I think once city staff see something in action, the pilot project actually becomes like a new goal moving forward. I hope that answers your question, Liz.
Yeah, that's wonderful. And just from the inverse side, in terms of the ultimate impact of kind of really intentional, inclusive community engagement that not only involves working together to find the answer to a problem, but also defining the question or the problem in the first place. The ultimate result of that is the solution, the experiment, the project, whatever the case is ultimately going to be more impactful, just because it's going to more deeply reflect the views and the needs of those most affected. I think that's really good. We have a couple more questions. One from Jessica. As someone inspired by your work, working in a municipality as an engagement professional and without a creative background myself, I struggle with knowing where to start with respect to building creative partnerships to animate public spaces. Any advice?
I'm just trying to type up a little response to that now. So I'll finish this thought and then speak to it maybe as well.
While you do that, Sam, I'll just mention where my mind goes, Jessica, is to look to your local arts community, arts organizations, museums, galleries, civic animators, who do have a creative background. And I think teaming up together with your expertise in engagement and kind of civic issues and their creativity, we actually always think of ourselves not as the experts, but to seek the expertise that we need and linking up with them. But Sam, I'm sure you have a lot to add to this.
Well, I mean, that's in perhaps different words, basically the same thought that I was trying to express. I think we often, when we are tasked with these, find ourselves in these positions with these tasks before us, it feels like we need to do it all ourselves. But I think the underlying lesson here, as Dave was saying, is that we've got to remember that we live in community and there are others who, you know, have other skills that they can bring to the table. The thing that sort of holds it all together and allows these working relationships to be productive is trust that must be built, though. And I think that trust building component, that relationship building and maintaining component is A, extremely important and valuable, but B, does not necessarily and often does not abide by the like deadlines and timeframes that rigid processes often adhere to. But I think that's, again, part of what I find so rewarding about working in an organization like the Bentway, because even when we are not explicitly in a consultation period, we are constantly in this stance of trust building, relationship building, and you know, just dialogue, conversation with those around us in our city, in our community, in our networks.
Yeah, I love that consultation or engagement, not as a phase, but baked into the whole process itself. That's great. There was an earlier conversation about crime prevention through environmental design or safe growth. Dave, did you have any kind of additional thoughts you wanted to add to that?
I might draw a thread between that earlier question and a question that I saw in the chat about how we engaged with unhoused populations and people who are experiencing homelessness. There are sections of the Gardiner Expressway where there are people living outside in tents and encampments. And I think it's fair to say that the Bentway staff have gone through kind of a rendering to reality journey where, you know, when the Bentway phase one site was imagined, it was a site of artistic programming and performance and community connections and recreation. And the needs and traffic patterns of unhoused residents were under considered. I think it's fair to say. I think when we built phase one, we were building it for a certain audience type, and it was people living in local condos. And there's this whole other group that uses and has real needs from public space, you know, needs for washrooms and running water and power and Wi-Fi and much more. So we've gone through, I think, a real visceral learning process ourselves, in particular through our site team, who are dealing with all sorts of visitors to our site in a very real way. We started an internal working group of staff focused on meeting the needs of unhoused residents. We had to think really carefully about what the Bentway's role was. We're not a housing provider, we're not social service professionals, and really decided that our role as a public space is to be welcoming to everybody and to think of unhoused residents as a user group of our site, they're our clients, they're our audiences. So we've built really good relationships with a number of local social service agencies, respite centers, supervised injection sites. And I'd say are doing some light programming engagements and connections with the communities. Through Sam's work on the public ground plan, as we look further afield to the Gardiner in its length, we actually think it's really important to bake in predictable amenities that serve both housed residents and unhoused residents across the length. You know, there needs to be publicly accessible washrooms every certain number of meters along the corridor. We need to design for people who are going to be using Wi-Fi and charging their phones, because spaces like the Bentway and other parks are their only opportunity to do so. We've also, I noticed in Bettina's comments, the idea of like anti-stigma type work. You know, as much as we've tried to embrace our unhoused residents, unhoused neighbors as a user group, other users of our site might see them differently. So our site team has done a really good job at putting our code of conduct in practice. Our code of conduct is there not only to, you know, control and shape how our space is used, but to tell all visitors from our site that everyone is welcome and that in fact, we all belong in public space and that public space all belongs to us, whether we have a roof over our heads or not.
I'll add to that, coming out of our conversations with folks at the respite centers, at the shelters, just on the streets, it struck me that the things that, you know, A, being clear about what is on the table, what we are actually able to influence, again, that was very important for just setting context for the conversation. But that said, people understand. And the things that they're advocating for, that they're asking for, are not only beneficial to a small subset of the population. These are things that have universal appeal. And that, I think, is just another reminder that regardless of where you sleep at night, you know, we're all people and, you know, often have similar needs.
Yeah, thank you both. We have time for just one or two more questions. Thank you to everyone that sent them in. This came from a few different people, just looking for support on finding funding for these types of project pilot projects. Where would one start?
Great question. Fundraising, I think, is one of our biggest challenges. Where we've seen the greatest success is actually finding multiple lenses and multiple angles through which to pitch our work. So, you know, we described these demonstrators or pilot projects or creative experiments to you in a certain type of language. We've become really adept at having a number of pitches. So having a project that can be pitched to our local arts council as an artist-led project. The same project using a completely different set of language to our local destination marketing organization or to a provincial funder that cares about tourism activity. A slightly different set of language to talk to our local business association. A different set of language to talk to a philanthropist. So our fundraising team has got really, really good and smooth at changing voices. Imagine it like different paths up the mountain. So I would say allow yourself the freedom. If you have a demonstration project, a pilot project in the works, allow yourself the freedom to find different roads in. Don't think of your project description as being singular, but actually having to redraft it over and over again.
Yeah, that's wonderful. And I think a really interesting approach, even just from a project planning or project management point of view, to consider your different audiences and to put that into practice. Thanks for that, Tave. Unfortunately, we are coming up against time here. So just wanted to take a moment first to thank our audience members who have submitted their thoughts and questions. Apologize if we weren't able to get to your question, but I will try to pass some of those on and see if we can get just some short written responses to those as well. But also a big thanks to Dave and Sam for your wisdom, your insight, and your experience. Just seeing from the chat the reactions to this conversation, I think this is touching a lot of people and acting as some great inspiration and hopefully helping to equip changemakers across Canada and the US. So thank you very much.